So I will make an overview of what I've been working on these years. So I try to keep it kind of simple, okay? I will start with some pictures. This is, okay, I'll go back. Okay, so this is our research center where Mario, for instance, was working for some time. This is a chemistry tower, so all this building has chemical research. Our center has some labs here in the 11th floor. And so this is a view. This is our institute, the campus, with different buildings in both sides. We have also sports installations, tennis courts, swimming pools, football game, etc. And this is a view of the city with the Tagus River and the several hills. This is a castle. So here we do not have this beautiful view, but it's a nice place to work. So I hope you can have the opportunity to come and visit. I will start by presenting our research group. It's a very small research group. This is Professor João Costa Pessoa, which was visiting here 2 years ago in a summer school, so maybe some of you know him. This is me. We have one postdoc, Pedro, that works in catalysis mainly, and currently two PhD students, Cristina and Carlos. So Cristina is also working in bioinorganic, and Carlos is also more working in catalysis. So we are well equipped, maybe not as well as you are here, because I'm quite impressed with all your installations and equipment. But for the work we do, we rely a lot on spectrophotometers. We have a circular deep prism spectropolarimeter, which is the same as the one you use here. I also do a lot of work with continuous wave EPR, NMR, of course. This is our routine instrument, and also of fluorescence. And we have a small equipment for measuring viscometry. In terms of the metal ions, I work more. I did a lot of work with vanadium 4 and 5, and I will present today some work also with copper, zinc, and we are also doing some more work with ruthenium. Well, for the organic chemists in the audience, this is not so interesting because basically we do shift bases and this type of simple condensation ligands. We have a tradition in our group of working with amino acids and peptides, and also aromatic heterocycles. So, basically, our approach, what we want to know in our research, is if the complexes that we prepare have therapeutic activity, typically in vitro. Sometimes, if possible, we will try to have results in vivo. We want to know how the complexes are transported in biofluids, in serum, for instance. And, of course, the big question is which is the mechanism which is responsible for their activity. Our methodology is, I think, the usual one, synthesis and characterization by as many techniques as possible to get a good characterization of the complexes. An important parameter is the stability in aqueous media for a certain period of time, and of course determining the solubility. If the complexes are stable, we do evaluation of cytotoxicity, and we have collaborations to determine different therapeutic activity like anti-cancer, anti-parasitic, anti-tuberculosis, etc. If the complexes show no stability when in contact with aqueous media, we can try other applications like catalysis. Of course, we do studies with DNA nucleobases or other oligonucleotides, and studies with serum proteins to evaluate their transport. So this is the type of studies we usually do. It's basically the same that you do here, or you usually do in bioinorganic lab, titrations by different spectral fluorimetric techniques. With DNA we do melting studies, viscometry, and we have we also do electrophoresis, and we have a collaboration for AFM, atomic force microscopy evaluation. Also with albumin and transferrin, which are typically the proteins that we evaluate, that we study, we do again the same type of techniques, and we are developing mass spectrometry technique also to evaluate the binding and, of course, depending on the system, EPR. So today I will try to present a few systems that have been working. Vanadium solid complexes, vanadium and copper complexes with 8-hydroxyquinoline, and vanadium and copper complexes with shift bases derived from salicylaldehyde and amino acids. And I will also present a few results that we had with the zinc phenantrolene complexes. So this is kind of an old work. This was my PhD work. At the time, we were interested in evaluating and getting complexes which show the ability to replace insulin, so insulin mimetic complexes. And there was a lot of work done with Salden ligands. Salden ligands are the result of a condensation between two salicylaldehyde molecules and ethylenediamine, and they usually have a double bond here. But that double bond renders them not stable to hydrolysis, so usually they are not stable compounds. So we decided to study complexes with these ligands that we call salan, okay? And they have a CN single bond instead of a CN double bond. I prepared a series of compounds with different substituents on the salicylaldehyde ring. This one is derived from a pyridoxal, which is it's well tolerated by the body because it is involved in some processes with, I think, vitamin B6. And at this time, what we usually do is we try to evaluate the stability of these compounds and their behavior in an aqueous solution by pH potentiometry, because we wanted to know what would be the fate of the complexes if they were taken orally, went through the stomach, which has a very low pH, and then into the bloodstream, in which the pH is 7.5. And we wanted to know if these complexes could go through all these steps and still be a complex and not just vanadium and some ligand. And so here you see speciation curves, okay? And so typically with these Salden complexes, we had very high stability. One species, or here for instance, this is basically, these three species are basically the same with different protonation states in this pyridinic nitrogen. And so we knew that these were stable compounds. So probably they could go through the whole process, the whole ingestion, and go through the bloodstream. Of course, you cannot do only potentiometry. You also have to corroborate your results by other techniques. And for vanadium 4, we use EPR. For vanadium 5, we use vanadium NMR. And for this ligand with pyridoxal, we had kind of interesting results, because in all the pH range, we always have two isomers, either as vanadium 4 or vanadium 5. So basically, they are very similar, except in their coordination modes. Some of these compounds were tested. So the objective was for them to become insulin mimics. So we evaluated the cytotoxicity in three different concentrations in the fibroblasts. And for this therapeutic activity, we don't want them to kill cells. We want them to show low cytotoxicity. And this is one of our compounds. So this was a study which was made with a huge battery of complexes. And our complex, this one showed low cytotoxicity, particularly for after. So the cytotoxicity increased with time, of course, but for concentrations below 100 micromolar, they were not that toxic. Their glucose intake was evaluated in also in fibroblasts, and our complex is here, which is the region where we want it, so it stimulates glucose intake. We also try to evaluate with human erythrocytes their uptake. These were chosen because they are good models for cell uptake. And what we did was we dissolved the complex under air at pH 7.4, and we obtained the vanadium 5 complex. And then we analyzed the erythrocyte lysates, and we saw an increase in the vanadium 4 inside the cells. So this means that the vanadium goes inside the cells as vanadium 5. When it gets in, it is reduced to vanadium 4. So the effect that we were seeing here is probably due to vanadium 4 complex. However, the results were not so exciting because if we compared our complex with sodium vanadate, for instance, the inorganic analog, our complex shows worse results.